Welcome to the first instalment of my new series on super predators here on Real Paleontology. And here we're going to explore the life and times of the most awesome predators that have stalked the Earth over the last 500 million years or so. And we begin with a piece on my all-time favorite, the weird, wonderful, and wickedly weaponized marsupial lion, aka Thylacoleo carnifex. Here he is mounted on the wall behind me. And here he is next to the skull of a saber-toothed cat, Smilodon, just to give you a sense of scale. This bust was built around an actual cast, so it's life-sized. Thylacoleo has excited controversy and sometimes heated debate ever since it was first described over 160 years ago. And it can still get paleontologists a bit hot and bothered even today. I've spent decades studying and publishing on this beast, and it never ceases to fascinate me. I could talk for hours. So to spare you, I will break this up into multiple short and easily digestible videos. So this ferocious predator was absolutely unique in many ways, but I'm going to start with answering a perennial question. How did Thylacoleo kill its prey? In this respect, I believe that Thylacoleo stood alone among furry mammalian predators. There has never been anything else like it. I'm going to explain how and why, but first, a bit of backstory. Thylacoleo is the biggest mammalian predator that Australia has ever had, and Australia has been around for a very long time. Based on my own estimates published here, it was up to 160 kilo or so. That's about 350 pounds. It probably averaged closer to 100 kilo though, and specimens from the far west and down south in Tasmania tended to be smaller. Incidentally, there were plenty of big potential prey species available to it, 200 kilo kangaroos and hippo-sized wombat-like marsupials, among others. Thylacoleo was widespread, found in pretty much every Australian state and territory. It was, of course, a marsupial. Its closest living relatives are koalas and wombats, not cats. It was first described in 1859 by Sir Richard Owen, an eminent paleontologist of the time. Owen was, by all accounts, a bit of a cranky old bugger, but he was certainly no fool, and he was in absolutely no doubt that the marsupial lion was an active predator, describing it as among the fellest and most destructive of predatory beasts. But for decades, controversy raged over Owen's interpretation. Some argued that Thylacoleo wasn't a meat eater at all, but a dedicated plant eater. Others actually argued that it sucked eggs for sustenance. Some that it was a carnivore, but that it was simply incapable of killing prey and was restricted to some kind of lowly scavenging existence. Why all this confusion? Well, there are a few reasons, but one stands out. Thylacoleo did not sport the big conspicuous canine teeth common to most mammalian predators that we know today. Instead, it had these enormous rodent-like incisors. Consequently, because big predators like lions and tigers and bears do have big canine teeth, it was assumed that fossil species without them could not be carnivores or active predators. Problem is that this interpretation is based on entirely false premises. Lots of living species with big canines are definitely not predators. Take gorillas, for example, and even some cute little deer species. Even among active predators, the canine teeth themselves aren't usually critical in the kill, especially for big cats, and they have little to do with how efficiently a carnivore can extract meat from its prey. If you want to know whether a mammal is a carnivore or a herbivore, you need to look past the canine teeth to the cheek teeth behind them. This is where it's really at. Card-carrying carnivores have big, vertically slicing teeth that act like secateurs or shears. These are great for shearing through meat and other tough, fibrous stuff like ligaments and sinews. But they're pretty much useless for anything else, hopeless for processing plant material, and no good for processing bone either. If you want to crack bone, you use a hammer, not a knife. So big slicing cheek teeth are the hallmark of a mammalian carnivore. The bigger they are, the more carnivorous the animal probably was. Among known predators, cats are the most carnivorous, hypercarnivores. As you can see in this saber tooth, their meat shearing teeth, carnassials, are really big. But wait for it. Here are the meat shearing teeth of the marsupial lion. Frankly, they make the carnassials of the saber cat look like kid stuff. Like the Thylacoleo once said to the saber cat, "That's not a carnassial, this is a carnassial." Not only that, but functionally, this is the only cheek tooth that Thylacoleo has. There's nothing behind it or in front of it that would be any use at all in processing plants or cracking bones. I reckon the idea that the marsupial lion was not a carnivore was always just plain silly, as was the idea that it was perhaps a specialized plant eater or scavenger. But what about its capacity to kill? If we want to know how it did this, we need to look first at how living carnivores do it. And cats are probably our best analog here. Now, cats, like most predators, use different techniques depending on the size and type of prey that they're trying to kill. Smaller prey are easy. A bite to the base of the skull or neck will finish them off fast. But big prey are a different matter altogether. Killing big prey is tough, dangerous work, even for the king of beasts, the lion. Lions are often seriously injured and sometimes killed trying to take down and kill big animals like cape buffalo and zebra. Killing big prey is a slow, hard-fought process, usually delivered by a suffocating bite to the neck. In the case of a cape buffalo, the lion may have to hang on for 10 minutes or more, and that's a very long time to hang on to a ton of angry, desperate buffalo. Things get even worse if the buffalo has mates around, and they usually do. In this process, the lion's canines do little work. Even lion's canines are barely long enough to pierce the thick skin on the neck of an adult buffalo. Suffocation is what does the job here, and what you need to achieve this is a powerful bite. Just as an aside, jaguars are perhaps an exception to the rule here among cats. With their exceptionally robust canines and more powerful jaws than other cats, jaguars are known to crush the skulls of quite big animals, including tapirs. But it's doubtful that they could do the same to a cape buffalo, and they certainly will still use a throat bite when necessary. This just reinforces the fact that a big bite is a way better indicator of a predator's capacity to kill than the size of its canine. Sabretooths are an interesting exception here, but more on them later. So if it's all in the bite, how does the marsupial lion stack up against the competition? Well, I'm glad that you asked. Just so happens that in 2008, I built computer models of a lion skull and a Thylacoleo skull. My simulations showed that the marsupial lion could bite much harder than a lion of the same size, especially when biting at the meat-shearing carnassial teeth. And earlier, back in 2004, I published this paper along with some colleagues. We called it Bite Club. Taking measurements from the skulls of 49 living and extinct species, we estimated the bite forces that could be generated by the two main jaw-closing muscles. If we look at this line here, animals appearing above it are biting hard for their size, and animals below the line have weaker bites. We found that pound for pound, Thylacoleo here was a clear winner among big predators. Marsupial lion aside, a couple of other species really popped out in surprising positions, among them the saber-toothed cat Smilodon. Here we see that for its size, the fearsome saber cat actually bit like a pussy. Why is this so, you ask? Basically, I think this is because the saber cat had a very different way of killing. We published this paper on the biomechanics of a Smilodon kill back in 2007, and we'll go into this in a little bit more detail in another episode. But in short, we confirmed that the big saber cat likely killed by driving those huge knife-like saber teeth into the neck of its prey using powerful neck muscles. This was would have severed the windpipe and major blood vessels, resulting in a quick, efficient kill. It didn't need huge jaw muscles or a particularly powerful bite to do this. And by killing its prey quickly, it reduced the chances of being damaged by the prey animal or of attracting the unwelcome attention of other big predators. Smilodon was a big prey specialist. Here's another paper we published back in 2008, How to Build a Mammalian Super Predator. As you can see here, we found that Smilodon wasn't built like your average cat. Its heavily muscled body was more like a bear's. With powerful arms and a short back, it was built for strength and stability over speed and agility. This is perfect for taking down big, ponderous prey, but hopeless for taking down more agile creatures. The saber cat was a big prey specialist. Interestingly, Thylacoleo had a very powerful bear-like body too. As you can see, in this respect, it was very similar to Smilodon, despite the obviously major differences in head shape. It was similar to Smilodon in another respect too. The retractable claw on its thumb was much larger than its other claws. So where does the marsupial lion fit in light of all this evidence? It clearly doesn't slip easily into any existing category. Whatever it was doing, it was unique. We know that it had a massively powerful bite, way more so than any cat for its size. In this respect, it knocked Smilodon out of the park, and it quite easily outbid even the buff-headed jaguar. It also had a uniquely humongous set of meat-shearing cheek teeth. Still, it had the body of a big prey specialist, just like the sabre cat, and a big retractable claw on its thumb too. So what the heck was it doing? In order to shed some more light on this conundrum, we performed an experiment back in 2010. We CAT scanned the skull of a marsupial lion and generated a solid brass model. We then stuck it into a material testing system at the University of Newcastle and ran it through its paces. The result was another surprise. When biting into the neck of a sheep carcass, the robust but rather odd-looking big incisor teeth at the front of the jaws effectively pull the muscle on the sheep's neck into the massive slicing carnassial teeth, which then slice through this muscle like a hot knife through butter. It's pretty graphic, but if you want to see this experiment, it was the subject of a National Geographic doco. I've put a link to this in the About section of the channel page. Anyway, there's no doubt in my mind that a living sheep would have been killed very, very quickly. And in this simulation, this small marsupial lion was biting nowhere nearly as hard as it could have. In short, my interpretation of the marsupial lion's predatory MO is that, like Smilodon, the marsupial lion was a big prey specialist. Having immobilized and brought down big prey using its powerful forelimbs and using the retractable claw on its thumb like a grappling hook, it killed them quick, severing the windpipe and major arteries in the neck with its immensely powerful bite and meat-shearing carnassial teeth. This is a unique way of effectively achieving the same result as Smilodon, a fast, safer kill, minimizing the threat to the predator. It also probably killed smaller, but still quite large prey by driving those big spike-like incisors into the base of the skull, like a jaguar on steroids. My friend, colleague, and past PhD student, Rex Mitchell, delves into this latter scenario in a bit more detail on his channel, The Scullywag Lab. I encourage you to take a look. Altogether then, Thylacoleo went into the fight with a uniquely deadly combination of tools and techniques, but it still worked from the same basic playbook as Smilodon. To get up close and personal with big prey, take them down and kill them fast. An abundance of meat for relatively little effort. The downside is that its massive, heavily muscled body was very poorly designed for catching smaller, more agile prey. If big prey got scarce, There was no plan B. To finish up, there are two propositions that I'd like to address here. Firstly, although everyone now seems to agree that Thylacoleo was an active predator, some still argue that it could not have killed its prey with its jaws. Instead, they argue that it tore its prey apart with its big thumb claws. I think this is wrong for two basic reasons. Firstly, I think that our experiments quite clearly show that it could have easily killed with its overwhelmingly powerful bite. Secondly, why on earth would it have evolved such an extremely powerful bite if not to kill? It's clearly not a specialized bone cracker, and you absolutely do not need so much power in order to slice meat from bone. A big skull and huge jaw muscles like these suck energy, and evolution hates unnecessary waste. Just doesn't make sense to me. A very relevant point here is that the size of the thumb claw on Thylacoleo has been very seriously overhyped. It was big for sure, but not that big. Last year, a student of mine, Jack McGregor, looked into this in detail. The actual thumb claw is not preserved in any specimen of the marsupial line. What we do have preserved is the bone at the tip. Making predictions based on measurements from living cats and marsupials, what Jack showed is that the actual thumb claw in Thylacoleo was no more than 3 to maybe 5 centimeters long, or roughly between 1 and 2 inches, relatively no bigger than the thumb claw on Smilodon. What makes its thumb claw look so huge is that the other claws on its hand are really quite small, much smaller than the same claws on a cat. Good luck trying to kill a 200 kilo kangaroo with a 2-inch knife. There's one last argument that I'm going to address, the notion that the marsupial lion was in fact some kind of tree-dwelling drop bear, that it either regularly stalked tree-dwelling prey or routinely launched itself from the trees onto unsuspecting prey below. Could Thylacoleo climb trees? Yeah, for sure, to a point. With those powerful arms and sharp retractable claws, it could probably have scaled a telegraph pole with ease. But large adults that could have weighed 100 kilo or more could not have navigated the smaller branches that they would have had to in order to catch the relatively small prey available up there. Smaller branches simply could not have supported their weight. And why would a big prey specialist want to take the risk just to grab a small evening snack? As for the idea that it regularly hurled itself onto prey below, this seems really unlikely to me too. This kind of behavior is an easy way to hurt yourself, and the bigger you are, the harder you fall. With rare exceptions, living big cats rarely attempt this. It has occasionally been observed in leopards. On an average, leopards are much smaller than Thylacoleo. What is more likely is that, like leopards, the marsupial lion sometimes hauled its prey into the trees to protect it from other predators. What kind of other predator might have been formidable enough to give concern to a 160 kilo marsupial lion that could take a man's arm off with one bite, you might ask? Well, there was the giant venomous lizard, but we'll consider that in another episode. Sleep well, and don't forget to subscribe to the channel if you want to find out more. And here's a list of references for anyone who wants to delve into the mysteries of the murderous marsupial lion in a bit more detail.